Good morning.
Good morning.
Our Old Testament reading this morning is taken from Numbers 21, verses 4 through 9. Then the people of Israel set out from Mount Hor to take the road to the Red Sea, to go around the land of Edom. But the people grew impatient with the long journey, and they began to speak against Moses and God. "Why have you brought us out of Egypt to die here in the wilderness?" they complained. "There is nothing to eat here and nothing to drink, and we hate this horrible manna." So the Lord sent poisonous snakes along among the people, and many were bitten and died. Then the people came to Moses and cried out, "We have sinned by speaking against the Lord and against you. Pray that the Lord will take away the snakes." So Moses prayed for the people. Then the Lord told him, "Make a replica of a poisonous snake and attach it to a pole. All who were bitten will live if they simply look at it." So Moses made a snake out of bronze and attached it to a pole. Then anyone who was bitten by the snake could look at the bronze snake and be healed. Amen.
You have three people today. You're not alone.
Are you really a leprechaun?
No.
You have red hair.
But you look like a leprechaun. But you have red hair, yeah. So what holiday are you celebrating?
St. Patrick's Day.
Very good. Did you see the parade yesterday? No?
No.
Let me tell you, Hamilton Township had their parade in the rain.
In the rain.
And it was 40 degrees and I froze, okay? Sitting on my front porch, I froze. Okay. Well, this morning, did you listen to Kathy read the scripture? Did you listen? We'll ask the bigger guys, okay? Did you listen?
Yeah.
Do you know what kind of animals it talked about?
Snake.
There you go. So somebody was listening. So it talked about a snake that the Lord told Moses to make a bronze snake and put it up on a pole, and that would save the people if they looked at it. So, my question is, what would it take for you to be saved from doing bad things? What would it take?
Fish.
Strength.
What?
Snake.
A snake?
No.
She said strength.
Strength. You need strength. Now, if your parents asked you to do something, would you do it right away?
Sometimes.
What would it take for you to do it right away?
Effort.
You can't repeat. What would it take for you to listen right away and do whatever mommy asked you to do?
By myself telling me to do it.
The time to do it?
Yeah.
Is it? Like, okay. How about if mom said, "There's going to be no dinner until you clean your room"?
Consequences.
Would you clean your room right away?
No.
Would you clean your room right away?
Yeah.
Maybe.
They're not real food motivated, okay. How about she's going to take away your phone?
I'll have a phone. Leave her.
Okay, so we'll talk about Joey this time. If mom said, "I'm taking away your phone until you clean your room," are you going to clean your room right away?
Yes.
Absolutely. See, if it's important, we'll do it, won't we?
Mm-hmm.
And it's different for every person. Because sometimes cleaning your room, well, you can put that off. But if there's a consequence that you really don't want to happen, like taking away your phone or not having dinner or maybe taking away dessert or taking away your play time. You're going to do things right away. Well, when God gives us a command, he doesn't say, do it when you want to do it. He says to do it. So should we listen to God and do what he asks us to do?
Yes.
Sure, we should. Because we don't know what's going to happen, right? So when you are asked this week to do something, I want you to try to do it right away, okay? And see what happens. Mom, we're going to ask you to report, okay? And Gigi, the same thing for you. When Gigi or Pop ask you to do something, I want you to do it right away. Okay? Okay. Thanks for coming. As we come to our time of prayer this morning, there are many prayer requests. So, our Heavenly Father, we thank you for the opportunity, oh God, to once again gather in this your house. We pray, oh God, that you would take from us those things that clutter our minds and our hearts. Clear them out, oh God, so that we can listen to your word this day. We thank you, oh God, for the many blessings that you have given us during this past week. And pray, oh God, that we would continue to have open eyes and ears and to hear them, to experience them, and then to give you thanks for each and every one. This day, oh God, many prayers for healing for Chrissy with dizziness turning her head, for Tom Wilson recovering from bypass surgery and pneumonia, for Bailey Chiotti dealing with dental issues, healing for John Kryling, for Angie in the hospital with an infection, prayers for Marie Burrick fighting cancer in her intestines and her kidneys, prayers for John Gafkin having surgery on Friday. Lord, many others need your healing touch this day. Lord, we pray for our police officer who was wounded in a shootout. Lord, we pray for his complete recovery. We also pray for all the officers involved, Lord, that they be able to process this situation. We also lift up the family of the gentleman that was killed, Lord, that you would provide them with peace for this situation, Lord. We don't know all the details, Lord, but we know that there's been a lot of trauma, and we know that there's pain. So, Lord, we pray that you would give peace to all those dealing with that issue this day. We pray for traveling mercies for Bill Castor traveling to Huntsville, Alabama next weekend. Give him a safe travel, that he be able to enjoy his time and be able to come back to us safely. Prayers for Asia. She goes back to college today. Prayers for Matt going back to college next week. And prayers for Nicole coming home on Thursday for spring break. Lord, many other college students will be on our roads, Lord, and we pray for safe travel for each and every one of them. We also lift up the Fulman family as we celebrate Bev's life tomorrow at her funeral. Lord, pray that you be with her children, Barry and Leslie. Lord, that they would have peace for that time of celebration of her life. So, Lord, we know, oh God, that you are in each and every situation, no matter what that situation is. But Lord, we just pray that you would continue to remind us of your presence. Lord, sometimes we fall so short. And Lord, please forgive us for those times when we have missed your calling in our lives. We have missed your presence. So Lord, wake us up. Help us, oh God, realize what's going on in our world and that you are in charge of each and everything. So now, God, we pray for this service once again. Lord, we pray for your message, that it would be heard and taken deep within our hearts. For we pray all of this in Jesus' most precious name. Amen. Our gospel lesson this morning comes from John 3:14 to 21.
Listen as Jesus continues to teach the people. Jesus said, just as Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes may have eternal life in him. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stands condemned already, because they have not believed in the name of God's one and only Son. This is the verdict. Light has come into the world, but people love darkness instead of light, because their deeds were evil. Everyone who does evil hates the light and will not come into the light for fear that their deeds will be exposed. But whoever lives by the truth comes into the light, so that it may be seen plainly that what they have done has been done in the sight of God. May God bless us as we meditate on these words this morning. Now, today's lesson is a perfect example of the New Testament using words from the Old Testament. Now, I hope you were listening to Kathy as she read the Old Testament lesson this morning. And that's why I tested the kids this morning. In the Old Testament, people were not happy with where Moses was leading them. They were more than a little unhappy, as was evidenced by the Old Testament lesson that was read. They were grumbling once again, and I believe that God was growing very tired of their complaints. Ungrateful, they spoke against God and they spoke against Moses for all that they were enduring. There's no bread, there's no water, and they detested that manna. God's answer? Venomous snakes. Can you see that God provided the saving grace for those who looked to the bronze snake that had been lifted up? He sent the venomous snakes, but then he sent something that could save the people as well. God was surely angered at the disobedience of the people, yet he provided a way for them to live. It didn't say they weren't going to get bit, though, did it?
No.
It said that if they got bit and they looked, they would be saved. So God didn't take away everything. He just made a way possible. Fast forward to the New Testament lesson, and we see that now God sends his Son in that so familiar verse of John 3:16. Once again, God is sending a way for people to live, even though the people were not on their best behavior. He said they liked the darkness better than the light. Of course, John's words here are a bit cryptic, for the people did not understand that Jesus would be lifted up on the cross to die. Did you catch that? The bronze snake was lifted up on a pole, and people would look at it and live. And now we know that Jesus would be lifted high on a cross to die. But yet people who followed Jesus would receive that gift of eternal life. The people, however, would remember that lifting up of the bronze snake, they knew and understood the truth that he was speaking. Jesus speaks of the darkness that has overtaken our people, once again disappointing God. He says, this is the verdict. Light has come into the world. And who is the light?
Jesus.
Jesus. But people love darkness instead. Everyone who does evil hates the light and will not come into the light for fear that their deeds would be exposed. Jesus lifted up is not something of honor. We lift up celebrities, especially today with the Oscars. Who's going to watch the Oscars? Right? We put people on pedestals thinking they need to be honored because they're better than everybody else. We think some people are perfect or untouchable or fantastic or gifted beyond belief. But when Jesus is lifted up, it's just not the same. You see, Jesus is lifted up to die, yet we lift up celebrities to honor them. Jesus was lifted up so that all those who would look to him and follow him would be saved. Just like that Old Testament lesson. Can you see how the images are related to one another? But this time, there's more at stake. Believing and following Jesus does more than just save our lives. It gives us life everlasting with him. But what will it take? What will it take for the world to stop loving darkness and step into the light of Jesus? Do you have the answer? What will it take for his so-called believers throughout the world to get their acts together and truly follow him and the commands that he's given us? What will it take for us to sacrifice our own selves to serve others before ourselves? What will it take for us to commit our lives, really commit our whole being to being a disciple? What will it take for all believers to speak truth, to stand up for truth and justice, no matter the consequence? They're all really tough questions, aren't they? We all struggle with living our faith 24/7, but that's what we're called to do. We are not perfect, nor will we ever be perfect this side of heaven. But that doesn't mean we're not to try daily to walk in our faith. Day by day, sometimes it's minute by minute, we are called to be walking truth of Jesus. And when we fail, and we will, we need to start over again. What will it take for us to change the world? Can we change the world? Can we change the world that has loved darkness so much more than the light? How ironic is it that we experienced the shooting this just a few days ago in Hamilton? And when somebody was talking to me about it, they looked it up and said, do you realize it's 3.1 miles from the church?
Yeah.
That's close. For many who say, not in my backyard, my friends, it is in our backyard. Now, I understand that there was alcohol involved and that would have fueled the fire. But yet I'm also reminded that when there is guns in the presence of alcohol, there is never a good outcome. So much darkness instead of light. Day by day, minute by minute, we are called to be the walking truth of Jesus. And when we fail, and we will, we need to start over. What will it take? As long as we don't rely on ourselves and our own strength, but instead lean on God, I believe that nothing is impossible. Jesus' sacrifice on the cross, his body lifted high on the cross, should be enough for every believer to understand the gravity of our task on earth. He was lifted high on that cross for each and every one of us. So what will it take for us to truly follow him? What will it take for you? Let's pray. Gracious God, we know that this sacrifice is nothing that will be repeated. It was done once for all. And we know, O God, that you will welcome us each and every time we fail if we continue to try again. So, Lord, bring us that peace of assurance. Bring us that promise that we will inherit eternal life when we give our lives solely to you. What will it take? It will take your strength in all of our lives so that we can be the walking truth of Jesus. Amen. May all of us leave here assured that Jesus is on our side, that what he did on the cross is for each and every one of us. Go with that story in your hearts and share it with the world so that we can lead the world out of darkness into the light of Jesus. Amen.